Hello students, today's lesson is theories of aging. The major purpose of this text is to introduce various theories of aging like functionality theory, disengagement theory, activity theory, continuity theory, age stratification theory, modernization theory, conflict theory and aging theory, cumulative inequality theory, interpretative theory and labeling theory. It also highlights importance of theories. On the completion of this lesson, you should be able to understand the different theories of aging, know old age as a social problem, acquire knowledge on developing theoretical frameworks of aging, and know the importance of social roles in functionalist theories. There are a number of different explicit theoretical frameworks concerned with the study of aging. Psychological and physiological perspectives upon aging focus upon the changes which happen to individuals. However, when focusing upon the social context with which aging occurs, both for groups and individuals, then theories derived from sociological perspectives are most pertinent. Examining and understanding of the social context of aging involves studies which look at questions concerned with the adaptation of individual, a micro scale approach, and of questions posed at the macro scale, that is concerned with the impact of aging upon social structures and vice versa. Social theories of aging are characterized both by the level of explanation at which they operate and by the assumptions and ideologies that underpin them. Disengagement theory. This is a theory which links both micro and macro approaches to the study of aging. Disengagement was the first explicit social theory that was concerned with aging and was originally formulated in Growing Old by Cumming and Henry. This theory posits that independent of other factors such as poor health or poverty, aging involves a gradual but inevitable withdrawal or disengagement from interaction between the individual and her his social context, and that this process is mutually beneficial. Thus, disengagement would be seen as functional or useful because it facilitates a smooth transfer of power from the old to the young. From this perspective, retirement is seen as a mechanism by which companies can predetermine levels of employee turnover, gives the individual a graceful exit from the pressure of employment, and creates employment opportunities for younger workers. Hence, disengagement is illustrated by retirement is a mechanism for ensuring equilibrium within society and the transition of social power across generations. By disengaging from activity, either employment or social, individuals prepare themselves for death. At the same time, society also prepares the individual for the latter phase of life. By withdrawing the pressure to interact and facilitate the entry of younger cohorts into the social world, and disruption caused by death of the individual is minimized. Disengagement therefore implies a triple loss for individual: loss of roles, restriction of social contact and relationships, and reduced commitment to social mores and values. Disengagement theory had a profound influence upon the development of gerontological research, partly because it was the first major theory and thereby generated considerable debate and discussion within the gerontological world. It has also been influential because it is appeared indicate the pathway to successful aging. In this case, the way to age successful was reduced social involvement and social interaction. Although it is a negative pathway to the successful aging, it is not conceptually different from other ways to a successful old age, such as dietary adaptations such as eating yogurt or religious or physical activity. Disengagement is a lifelong process. For the most individual, it takes place over a period of time rather than suddenly. Throughout the life course, the individual is continually acquiring and dropping particular social roles. Hence, it is problematic to design a research study which could easily incorporate this lifelong perspective. There is an implicit statement that disengagement is inevitable because death and biological decline are inevitable, although the nature and timing of disengagement will vary between individuals, historically and culturally. Again, to establish the inevitable of reduced social engagement process, methodological challenges. How can inevitable disengagement be differentiated from reduced level of social participation resultant from ill health or poverty? Disengagement is seen as adaptive for both society and individual. Reduced social engagement is seen as being beneficial. There is some empirical evidence to support disengagement theory in that older people to experience a loss of roles with aging, whether though retirement, the death of a spouse, or the departure of older children from home. However, old people, like other groups within the population, use strategies of substitution and compensation to offset for losses of role. The widowhood may remarry, or older people may replace widespread and looks-knit pattern of interaction with more intense, locally based networks. While empirical data may demonstrate reduced social activity with increasing age and inevitability, universality and essentially adaptive nature of these changes remain unproven. Indeed, the veracity of disengagement theory is further compromised because of involuntary nature of many disengagements, such as mandatory retirement and failure for disengagement to be demonstrated universally. Activity theory. The presumed inevitability of the process of disengagement, with its basis in the biomedical and sickness model of aging, has also been subject to extensive academic criticism. While disengagement theory has been highly influential in the development of social gerontology, empirically testing and debate have exposed its essential loopholes. It has, however, had an important impact in stimulating the development of counter theories, of which activity and continuity theories are the most significant. These two theories are concerned with the aging of individuals, although again approached from a macro level theoretical perspective. However, it still remains within the structural functionalist paradigm in that it is a concern with the maintenance of equilibrium within society. The focus is upon adaptation and integration into the social system, and again, it is prescribing a route to successful aging. Diametrically opposed to the notion of disengagement or activity theory. Developed by Having Hertz, this perspective maintains that normal and successful aging involves perceiving for as long as possible the attitude and activities of middle age. Here, midlife is a conceptualized as the success to which we are always looking back and always trying to regain, to compensate for the activities and roles that individual surrounds with aging. Substitutes must be found. Upon retirement from paid employment, the retiree must find other roles, such as voluntary work, to compensate for this loss. It is assumed that any type of activity can be substituted for lost role. The assumption is made that the meaning and value attached to different activities are the same, and that all members of society share these meanings. Both these assumptions may be unfounded. Activity theory is a perspective view of aging which argues that activity and engagement offer the path to successful aging. This is a socially based manifestation of the use it or loss it. Conceptualization of successful aging and is the mirror image of disengagement, but is equally judgmental and perspective. Continuity theory. Continuity theory holds that in the course of growing older, the individual will attempt to maintain stability in the lifestyle he or she has developed over the years. Continuity theory suggests that in the process of aging, the person will strive to perceive the habits, preferences and lifestyle acquired over a lifetime, that there will be a process of evolution of activities as the individual grows older. Both disengagement and activity theory suggest that successful aging is achieved by movement in a single direction. Continuity theory, in contrast, starts from premise that individual will try to pursue the favored lifestyle for as long as possible. It then suggests that adaptation may occur in several directions according to how the individual perceives his or her changing status. The theory is rather less dogmatic in that it does not assert that one must disengage or become active in order to cope with the aging. Rather, the decision regarding which roles are to be disregarded and which maintained will be determined by the individual's past and preferred lifestyle and potentially by structural factors such as income and health. Unlike activity theory, this approach does not assume that lost roles need to be replaced. Continuity theory, therefore, has the advantage of offering a variety of patterns of successful aging from which the individual can choose. Building a generally applicable theory from this basis is therefore difficult. From a research and policy perspective, it stressed that need to understand the biography and life course of the individual in attempting to understand her or his experience of later life. As such, it is a more person-centered approach and stresses that links between old age and earlier phases of life. Age stratification theory. This is another good example of theory which is concerned with the adaptation of groups rather than of individual older people. Again, the concern is with examining social integration but from basis of age-based groups, and it flows out of the consensus approach. Society is often conceptualized as being stratified or divided along a number of dimensions such as social class or ethnic status, and those factors are used to allocate social roles. Age stratification theory uses chronological age as the defining and role allocation variable. Riley argues that each age group, young, middle life and old, can be analyzed in terms of the role that members of that group play with society and how these are valued. For example, within this employment field, workers may be classified as older and younger, and the latter valued more highly because of their perceived greater productivity, innovation and vitality. The use of chronological age in guiding the allocation of social roles is probably universal to all cultures, but the precise nature of these age norms reflect the culture, history, values and structure of specific societies. For example, over the 20th century, there have been substantial variations in some aspects of life cycle. Childbearing and child rearing are now confined to a much shorter period than previously when women are reproductively active, for 25 to 30 years. This has been matched by the creation and increase in the duration of the emptiness phase of life cycle. Similarly, within specific societies, the size, composition and history of particular cohorts influence both the timing and order of the major life events. The existence of compulsory national service will delay the major life transitions such as marriage, going to university or starting a career. These age norms in behavior may originate in tradition, factual regularity or negotiation. Whatever the origin, they are based upon assumptions, explicit or implicit. These norms may, however, vary with social class, ethnicity or sex historically or culturally. For example, members of working class traditionally marry at an earlier age than members of the professional classes. Similarly, age at first marriage is usually older for males than for females. Because of these variations, age norms have different realities and meanings for varying social groups. Despite this, age is a universal criterion for role allocation. The age grading of roles within an age stratification system creates age differences and inequalities. Each age group is evaluated both by itself and other in the society in terms of the dominant social values. This differential evaluation of roles will produce an unequal distribution of power and prestige across age group. Thus, when societies value the accumulated experience and wisdom of the old and allow them to undertake roles that capitalize upon this experience, then the age will be accorded a position of respect. Modernization theory. The position of older people in pre-industrial society is usually described as one of the respect and authority. Typically, pre-industrial society is depicted as the golden age of aging and older people, although every stage in history seems to look back to its own golden age. This stereotypical view of this past is usually contrasted with their position in modern society, where older people are thought to be worse off because they are consigned to meaningless retirement, neglected by their family and ignored by the prevailing youth culture. Cogwell and Holmes developed these ideas further. The process of modernization was defined by four parameters. First one is improvement in medical technology. Second one is the application to the economy of science and technology. Third one is urbanization. And fourth one is mass education. Cogwell and Holmes argued that improvements in health care led to an aging of decrease in the potency of death results in an aging of the working population and a decrease in job opportunities for the young. Thus, intergenerational tensions are created by the competition for jobs. Retirement then becomes a social substitute for death and creates jobs opportunities for the young. However, the dominance of the prevailing work ethic results in a devaluing of retirement. Additionally, economic and technological developments devalue the employment skills of the old. Urbanization attracts young people from the rural areas, resulting in a breakup of the extended family. Finally, the development of mass education reduces the hold older people have over younger people. Changes in these four factors contributed, it was argued, to a decrease in the status of the older people in modern society. In such developing social settings, youth and progress are extolled while the traditions and experience of the old are developed and seen as irrelevant, and their reduced power and prestige places them at a disadvantage. The old became socially and physically abandoned and live a marginal existence on the fringes of society. Again, pre-industrial societies illustrate a degree of diversity in the attributes displayed toward older people, and it is universe to presume a homogeneity that is more fable than fact. Conflict theory. As its name suggests, conflict theories take a rather different view of the organization of society than functionalists, who stress the values that different social groups have in common. In contrast, conflict theory, which derives from neo-Marxist and neo-Weberian views of society, stresses discord and conflict. Gerontological applications of this theoretical perspective are much less common than theories from the functionalist perspective, but include the highly influential structured dependency theory and political economy approach to the aging. This perspective upon aging become very important in the development of radical dimensions of British gerontological developments and has key protagonists in the United States and Europe. Such themes were not, however, unique to the field of aging, but demonstrated a wider research sense across the social science. Cumulative inequality theory. Inequality is present in all societies, with some persons having more resources, opportunities, and influence than others, although some viewpoints regard inequality as the result largely of personal action, human agency. We conceptualize the major antecedents of inequality as systematically structured. People make choice that influence inequality, but the choice available throughout the world are quite varied, signifying that human agency is always constrained by the opportunities structured by social institutions and culture. There is a need to recognize the primacy of how inequality is systematically generated and thereby difficult to eliminate. Although many scholars recognize the existence of structural determinants of inequality, what cumulative inequality theory adds its greater articulation of how these determinants are manifested through demographic and developmental process. Demographic process refer to cohort linked stimuli, events and experiences. Developmental process refer to age linked stimuli, events and experiences that can be observed in individuals. What may not be readily apparent, however, is that a course of scholars interpret these two sets of process from a single indicator, age. Gerontologists have long recognized that age is a crude indicator that is often confounded with period or cohort. The age period cohort confound, this fact often escapes the view of many studying how inequality accumulates over the life course. Aging is a highly dependent on social context, reflecting gene pools and social organization at the point in history. Recognizing the demographic developmental dialect, cumulative inequality theory holds that childhood conditions are important to adulthood. Based on research during the past decade, we now have compelling evidence that childhood conditions structure the life course. This is not just in terms of personality formation and stability, but also in terms of achievement and well-being. Scholars have long seen the interconnectedness of life stages. But what has been most stimulating to this area of inquiry is whether early insults have long-term consequences. Or later, life outcomes depending on childhood experience. Does gestational health influence health in later life? The answer to these questions appears to be affirmative, but isolating the mechanisms for these long-term connections remain a matter of continuing inquiry. Beyond childhood as a life stage, we assert that gerontologists would be wise to recognize that reproduction is a fulcrum for defining the life course trajectories and population aging. Puberty is widely accepted as a key biological step in the transition to adulthood, and reproduction is a marker for adulthood in many societies. But what follows reproduction? When we think of aging as a life stage of growing older, we are probably referring to the post-reproductive stage of life. There may be some arbitrariness to such demarcations of growing older, and the reproductive schedules of men and women are distinct. The point is that gerontologists would profit from greater attention to conceptualizing the reproductive period as a pivotal life phase, one that leads to non-linearities in accumulation process. In addition, cumulative inequality theory privileges gender difference in the accumulation of inequality by noting the distinct process for men and women that lead to inequality. Inequality exists between the sexes in part because of biology, but within each sex because the accumulation process are often distinct. Biologists often refer to the post-reproductive period as senescence. For instance, Spence and describes senescence as a term used to describe the group of deleterious effects that lead to a decrease in the efficient functioning of an organism with increasing age and leads to an increased probability of death. This decrease in efficient functioning is most often attributed to an increase in molecular disorder. We think of defining the life course with more fluid boundaries, but feel that gerontologists should give greater attention to how the pre- and post-reproductive stages of life sandwich the time during which individuals are able to reproduce. As noted earlier, a major distinction of cumulative inequality theory is that it gives explicit attention to the intergenerational nature of inequality. Family lineage is a major source of inequality. Despite the legacy of sociological research on the intergenerational transmission of inequality, we have not been able to identify systematic coverage of this topic. Family lineage may influence the accumulation of inequality in many ways, but we identify four primary mechanisms. biological, social, psychological, economic and ecological. Any one of these mechanisms may be used in identify the influence of family lineage, but they frequently combine together. Labeling theory. It has been suggested that old age may usefully be conceptualized within the framework of the labeling theory of deviance. Labeling theory suggests that other groups attribute social status to individuals and or groups by the successful application to them of negative labels to confer stigma or deviant status. In a youth and health conscious society, old age may be defined or labeled as a deviant and stigmatizing condition. Indeed, those who work with older people may also attain this damaged or spoiled and identify by contamination with the stigmatized group. Coming into contact with the deviant group is sufficient to compromise the status and professional identity of individuals as well as the older people themselves. Such interactions may communicate a stereotypical image of older people as useless, dependent and marginal. The individual who accepts this negative labeling is inducted into the dependent negative position. Learning to act as older people are supposed to end losing previous skills, confidence and independence. Finally, the external label is accepted and the person defines her himself as inadequate, thereby creating a vicious circle. Thus, once people are labeled as old because they are retired, they have to play the role of a retiree and accept their pensions and not seek gainful employment. Similarly, the failure of older people to consult their doctor for specific symptoms because they think they are due to old age rather than interpreting them as signs of disease is another negative way that social labeling may affect older people. Importance of social roles in functionalist theories. Both disengagement and activity theory embrace the structural functionalist concept of social roles. Disengagement, activity and continuity theory are all to a lesser or greater degree concerned with how older people adjust to changes and losses in social roles. However, such concerns are also evident in other phases of the life cycle. Role loss is not exclusive to old age. All three theories offer a profoundly negative view of old age in which all roles changes are the result of loss. There is a little difference to new positive roles such as becoming great grandparents. Social role theory assumes the existence of a set of rules, regulations and roles, and then at an individual age there will be a change adaptation in the number of social roles an individual has and how they are executed. Here roles are conceptualized in the Personian sense and are defined in terms of both expectations of the role and orientation of the role. Roles are part of normative order of society and a powerful determinant of behavior as there are sanctions for deviation from social expectations. Put at its most strength forward, a social role can be conceptualized as a pattern of behavior expected from an individual who holds a particular social status defined in terms of social position. In the broadest sense, competing social roles differ in three main ways. First, roles will be emphasizing qualities. Some roles are defined in terms of the task undertaken, such as the worker role, while others are defined more in terms of emotional content, such as wife or husband. Second is, social roles vary in the type of reward offered, such as money, prestige, status, emotional support or satisfaction. Third is, roles are evaluated according to the values of the society.